Everyone, this is Myesha Thorpe at Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown University. I want to welcome you to today's presentation, Branding Yourself After Age 50. Today's presentation is by Marva Goldsmith, and she is a Georgetown Certificate alumnus. I'll tell you a little bit about her in a moment. I definitely want you to enjoy today's presentations. I have a few housekeeping tips and reminders to kind of help you navigate today. One of the things is today's presentation is being recorded. All registrants will be advised after today's presentation about how to access the archive presentation on our website. It usually takes us about a week or two to get it up, but if you ever want to replay the session, we'll have access to that. There are two audio options today. You can listen via your computer speakers, or you can dial into the conference bridge number that was provided in your email. One additional thing that I've learned recently is that if you have quite a few other applications open on your computer screen, so if you have other browsers open and other applications open, it can affect your audio quality. If you're having that problem, I either close a few programs or simply just dial into the conference bridge number to hear the audio. One additional thing is that we emailed a handout about an hour ago to everyone's email address that you used to register. So if you haven't logged into that account recently, please go ahead and do so. And there's a handout in correspondence to today's presentation. Questions are welcome today. We'll definitely have a question and answer period after the presentation. You'll feel free to type in those questions on your screen in your control panel. You can do that along the way or wait until we get to that time during the presentation. We'll be happy to answer as many questions as time allows us to do so today. If you're having any technical difficulties, please, if possible, submit those concerns via the chat area on your screen. I'm unable to check my personal work email, or take phone calls during this presentation, so I'm unable to assist you via phone in that way. While technical difficulties are disappointing to us and we try to avoid them as much as possible, if we have an issue that's the vendor problem or some concern that's out of our control, we will try to resolve that issue immediately and resume the session. If that takes longer than 5 to 10 minutes, we don't want to waste anyone's time today, so we will actually go ahead and cancel the session and reschedule at a later date and notify everyone of the rescheduled time. If there aren't any other things I want to share with you today. One other thing actually is that if you don't need a headset, I know some of the reminder emails mentioned that you could use a headset. You don't actually have to have one if you're in your office alone or if you're able to dial into the phone. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our wonderful presenter today. Marva L. Goldsmith knows the transformation process intimately because she has actually lived it. She began her career as an electrical engineer and later became a federal lobbyist. In 2001, she transitioned into image and brand management and became a certified image professional. Marva studied image management with Dominique Isbeck International, the London Image Institute, and the Image Resource Group, and attended the Peter Montoya Personal Brand University. She earned a master's in public administration degree with a concentration in leadership from Harvard University after the age 40. And received additional leadership training through the Center of Creative Leadership and Georgetown University's Leadership Coaching Program. Marva conducts workshops on personal branding and image management around the country for clients that include AARP, Enterprise Rent-A-Car, the federal government, as well as colleges, universities, and small businesses. She has recently spoken at the 2000 National HR Management Conference and will present at the National AARP Conference in October. Marva has published 6 workbooks, including Branding You Incorporated and Branding Yourself After Age 50. I want to welcome Marva today, and I'll turn it over to her.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for tuning in. Today, we're going to talk about branding yourself after age 50. I turned 50 on December 5th of 2008, and you know, I'm still getting over it. Actually, I shouldn't even say that. It's been great. It's been a great time because what I want and what my interests are. So one of the things that I have learned, however, with any situation that you encounter is it is really important to determine how you're seeing the situation. So one of the reasons why I wrote the book, Branding Yourself After Age 50, is that I started to realize just how many people have turned 50 or are older than 50 and find themselves in the midst of a career crisis, one that I'm calling at this point a unplanned career outage. The situation, of course, the economic situation has led to a lot of layoffs and downsizing, early retirements, you know, whatever you want to call it. But a lot of people in my age range now find themselves kind of starting over, and it's kind of scary, especially if you have not thought about either looking for a job at the age of 50 or starting a new business. You know, it can be a daunting task. So I wrote the book because there's so many people that are facing that situation. And the first thing that I tell them is to, you know, let's kind of define how you're looking at the situation. Is it a problem or is it an opportunity? And so as you can see, the donkey in the well, if you're not familiar with the parable of the donkey in the well, I'll tell you the story really, really quickly, and it should sort of bring to light why I wrote this book. So there was a farmer and a donkey, and they're walking along a field, and there was a well that was covered up, and unfortunately, the donkey fell into the well. So the well was really deep. The farmer looked down into the well and knew that he could not help the donkey get out of the well. And then he says, well, you know, the donkey is kind of old, and he's really served his purpose, so maybe I should just put him out of his misery, and I will fill the well up. So he ran to some of his neighbors and asked them to come and help him to cover up the well and to, you know, put the donkey out of his misery. So all the farmers started to shovel dirt into the well. And every time they shoveled, you know, a shovel full of dirt into the well, you'd hear the donkey screaming, you know, loudly, and, you know, because this dirt is hitting him and he's scared and he's in this well and they keep throwing this dirt on him. So after a while, you didn't hear anything. There's no noise. And the farmer and the other, his neighbors looked down into the well, and what they saw was every time they threw a shovel of dirt onto the donkey began to just shake it off and step up. And they kept shoveling the dirt on him, and he just kept shaking it off and stepping up. And so the moral of the story is that, you know, when we are faced with a crisis or a situation, what we need to do is first think about the donkey and just think about, you know, am I yelling and screaming, you know, upset or frightened, or have I looked at this as a potential opportunity and now I can just kind of shake it off and step up? And so as we look at this, you know, whatever your current situation is and why you decided to tune in today, you know, one of the things that I learned in the Georgetown coaching program is that what we choose to believe affects our results. So we really want to think about, you know, what we're believing about our current situation, how we're feeling, those thoughts, and then the behaviors that that causes, because that's what's going to affect the results. So what we need to do now is think differently about the situation. And what I'm going to ask you to do is to think about whatever your current situation is as the best opportunity you have had in a long, long time. And so with that, let's talk about personal branding. I always like to start off with a common definition of what personal branding is. So personal branding is simply a way to clarify and communicate what makes you different and special, and then use those qualities to guide your business and career decisions. And in your handout, you'll see, and in fact, there is a little space for you to talk about your situation, and there's also the definition for personal branding. So as we think about personal branding, branding itself started with commercial products. And I like to use Heinz ketchup as an illustration because everyone's familiar with Heinz. And through the use of Heinz ketchup, we can also have an understanding of how personal branding should be implemented in our own work, in our own life. The reality is you already have a personal brand. It's not something that you are just creating. It currently exists. the issue is that most people allow their personal brands to be developed either accidentally or by someone else. And so what we're going to talk about is intentional personal branding. So let's turn to Heinz and let's think about the product, ketchup. So with ketchup, you know, all ketchup is pretty much the same. There's tomatoes, there is spice, there will be some kind of sweetener. In most cases, it's high fructose corn syrup. And in the healthier versions, it might be brown sugar or something of that nature. But for the most part, we can agree that the ingredients for ketchup is fairly the same. However, Heinz ketchup managed to distinguish itself in the marketplace. And the way Heinz did that was by identifying the characteristics that make it different and special. In the case of Heinz, it is the thicker, richer ketchup. So when you think about Heinz, you always think about some of the commercials that help to distinguish it. And that's how, you know, a brand is developed. A lot of people think of a brand as a logo, but a brand is all those things, that the attributes that make it different and special, the way it communicates those strengths to its marketplace, and ultimately the real estate that it owns in the mind of the consumer. So what Heinz did was it started this campaign around recognizing it as being different and special. You might recall some of the commercials, like the shootout, where there were two ketchup bottles. One was Heinz, and they kind of walked in. They had on holsters, cowboy hats, and then they go draw, and of course, Heinz was the loser because it was so slow. There was another other commercials with the theme song in the background, which was sang by Carole King, sang, which was anticipation. And I won't sing it for you because that could be painful. But anticipation was the theme song for Heinz ketchup because, again, it is the slowest ketchup in the West. And the whole idea behind it was for people to begin to think of it as being worth the wait. That was the tagline. So as you start to look at the campaign for ketchup, this fairly mundane product that allowed Heinz to capture 40% of the market, it was all about creating an understanding of who they were in the marketplace, that they were the thicker, richer ketchup. And now they have even redesigned the bottle such that it sits upside down so that now you don't have to wait. So the question becomes for you, how are you like ketchup? How are you distinguishing yourself from all the other ketchup bottles on the shelf? If you think about it, let's say, for instance, you're an engineer or you're a human resources strategist. You might be a generalist in the office of which there are 10 other generalists. So let's take that example. If I'm an HR generalist and there are 10 other HR generalists, one way to distinguish myself, of course, is to begin to specialize in a particular area. It might be in benefits. It might be in compensation. It might be in retention and those kinds of other areas that are related to human resources. Now there are only 5 of us in the office with the same specialty. How else might I become different and special? You might join the Society of Human Resource Management and begin to distinguish yourself as a leader in the industry as opposed to just a leader or a specialist in your organization. So there are all kinds of different ways to start to think about how do I create myself, the product, as a product that's different and special from all the other ketchup bottles on the shelf. Really, really key that we have that understanding. Now, I'd like to look at another product, and that product is Coca-Cola. And actually, the product is Pepsi. There was a great commercial, and you can actually download it on YouTube. If you go to YouTube and just type in Jackie Chan beat Pepsi, or beat Coke, sorry, Jackie Chan beat Coke, you will see a YouTube commercial. Now, what's interesting about this commercial is that Coke is Diet Pepsi is filming a movie with Jackie Chan. And they start off by talking about the arrangement for Diet Pepsi. And so Diet Pepsi said, you know, their agent says, okay, great, we'll do everything, but we'll need a stunt double. So Jackie Chan says, yeah, that's great, we'll get the stunt double for you. So, of course, Jackie Chan is famous for adventure and lots and lots of action. So when the action comes, and I think that they're about to go over the cliff, the little can of Diet Pepsi is sitting next to Jackie Chan. He goes stunt double, and they bring in a can of Diet Coke, and that's what goes over the cliff. And then there's a second segment of it where someone's about to step on the can of Diet Pepsi, and Jackie Chan yells stunt double, and they bring again in the Diet Coke, and the Diet Coke is trounced. Okay. Now, the reason I bring that up is because it's all about vision. So, you know, first we talked about personal branding from the standpoint of what you want to do is to think about what makes you different and special. The other thing that's really important with personal branding is to have a vision. With Coca-Cola and Pepsi, Pepsi's vision has always been to beat Coke. And it took them like 108 years to finally exceed the Coke sales in the marketplace. But what was really clear about how they went about it was their vision never changed. Their vision has always been beat Coke. And even in this commercial, they don't talk about what makes Diet Pepsi different and special. They basically emphasize beating Coke. So the vision stays the same. And so the way to use this, and what I want you to think about is as you're thinking about this example, is that if you have a vision for yourself, it might be for your new company, it might be for a new job, it may be for, you know, something else that's going on in your life, but you have to be real clear about what the vision is. And so just like Diet Pepsi was clear about their vision, which is to beat Coke, and they brought that to the market, so now in the mind of the consumer, it's not about what makes Diet Pepsi different and special, it's simply about Pepsi being better than Coke and kind of placing that in a fairly humorous way in the mind of the consumer. So what is your vision? How are you going about creating everything and making sure that everything is in alignment with your vision? I can share with you very quickly that one of my key strategies was to become successful in internet activity, so internet sales either via webinars or products and things of that nature. And so I had to have a really long look at my strategy because before the beginning of the year, the strategy on the internet was not very aggressive. And so if my vision was to become successful as an internet marketer of my products and services, then my resources needed to be in alignment with that vision. So again, you need to ask yourself, what is my vision? What's the North Star? What is it that I want to accomplish? You know, as we start to look at this new situation, as we're looking at it as an opportunity, and we begin to identify what is the vision for how I'm going to make this situation an opportunity or move towards some North Star, how am I aligning my resources to make this vision a reality? So that's the real key there. And so you really want to think about this example, and I hope that you will go to YouTube and take a look at the commercial, and that will then become another piece of data for you to think about as you're developing your own strategy. So we've talked about two items that are really important in terms of creating your brand strategy for your personal brand. The first, of course, is identifying what makes you different and special. And the second is identifying a vision or a North Star. What is it that you want to accomplish? Because then it's much easier to start to identify how you distinguish yourself from everyone else that has a similar kind of vision or desire in that marketplace. The next thing we want to think about is brand promise. So with brand promise, that simply means, what am I promising to deliver to the marketplace? So if we go back to the example of Heinz ketchup, what they promise to deliver is ketchup that won't slide off of your French fries, if you recall some of their commercials. Their brand promise is that they will always deliver a thick, rich ketchup. Very simple. So let's take a look at another example, and this time I'd like to bring a personal brand example, and that example is Dennis Rodman. Now, I'm going to make a guess that the majority of people that are on the call today are in my age range, around 50, so you will, of course, remember Dennis Rodman. Now, Dennis Rodman has been off of the basketball court for probably about 7 years now. However, my guess is that when I show the picture, most people had some kind of idea about Dennis Rodman. Something absolutely came up for you. In most cases, when I'm in a live audience, I'll hear a few chuckles. I'll hear some kind of gasp, but there's always a reaction to Dennis Rodman. I like to use him as an example because he is such a great personal brand example of how to create strategy. Three things to think about. The first is leadership, which we've already talked about. Leadership is simply what makes you stand out, what makes you different and special. In Dennis Rodman's case, he was a leader in rebounding. Dennis would stop at nothing to get the ball. He would absolutely, and in this case, fly through the air to get the ball. And so he became a leader in rebounding. And in fact, he played on two championship teams and earned 5 championship rings. So people will always remember Dennis Rodman as a leader in rebounding. However, he was in the NBA, and the real key here is there are probably, you know, at least 10 others in the NBA who have excellent rebounding credentials. So the second thing you have to do, once you've established yourself as a leader, is to begin getting visibility for your role as a leader. Now, how did Dennis Rodman start to get visibility? Well, he started changing his hair color. And so here you see him on the David Letterman show on St. Patrick's Day, and he has colored his hair green. And so what was really clear about Dennis Rodman, when he was on the court and off the court, he was always very visible. He also not only started to change his appearance with hair color, the piercings, the body tattoos, but his visibility was kind of associated with some outlandish looks. In case you have forgotten, you might remember that he showed up in Central Park in a wedding dress because he was going to marry himself. So he got lots of visibility for his personal brand, because of his personal brand. The third area that you have to think about when we're creating personal brand strategy is consistency. A brand has to be consistent. So if, as an example, we go back to the Heinz example, if sometimes you open a Heinz bottle and it was thick and rich and sometimes it was runny, then the brand could not stand up to its promise. And so with a brand, you have to be consistent. One of the things we know about Dennis Rodman was he was fairly consistent on the court as well as off the court. And so what starts to happen is when you're consistent, when you create that visibility for the brand, when you have distinguished yourself in a certain way, you become known for something, and that is the brand promise. With Dennis Rodman, he was known for being outrageous. So you would always expect an experience of him to be outrageous. And I recall one time I was flipping through channels watching, watching television, and there was a commercial where Dennis Rodman shows up, and he's watching the Mole Yucatan, or he's going to be on the Mole Yucatan. Now, I, you know, think of myself as a relatively smart person. Not that folks that watch the Mole Yucatan wouldn't be smart, but it was just interesting how easily entertained I am by the Mole Yucatan. So I would turn in every Wednesday to watch an hour of Dennis Rodman. Why? Because I knew he would deliver a certain experience. And that experience was that I would laugh for, you know, hour, a half hour, whatever that time frame was. And he never failed to deliver. Now, if you saw him recently on The Apprentice, you had an idea of why his behavior was so outrageous. You know, he unfortunately had a problem. But the other thing to think about with Dennis Rodman, and Donald Trump actually acknowledged that the reason why they put Dennis Rodman on the show was because of the promise of an experience. So with personal branding and branding of any sort, you're always going to have a result that is either a decision or a purchase. Now, in this case, here you see Dennis Rodman on the cover of a milk advertisement, and this is with the milk producers. The question becomes, what's the message? So here you have the most wholesome product in the world, and they have decided to place Dennis Rodman in their advertisement. The message is clear. Even bad boys drink milk. So as we take this example, the example of Dennis Rodman, which is, you know, fairly absurd, but it makes the point. What are you a leader in? How are you distinguishing yourself in the marketplace? How are you getting visibility? So it's great if you have, you know, excellent credentials and you're really good at what you do, but if no one knows about it, then, you know, you need to really think about, how am I getting visibility for my role, this leadership role that I'm playing? There's so many opportunities out there, especially now with the internet, to get visibility for some special kind of attribute that you have. If you are a writer of any sort and you can contribute to a company newsletter, or if you have your own newsletter and you contribute to industry papers, I mean, anything like that is going to get lots and lots of visibility, and it's a wonderful way to get your name out into the public. Depending on what your field of expertise is, you really need to think about other avenues of getting visibility. The visibility should never be self-serving, however. So you need to make sure that, you know, and it's a fine line between self-serving visibility and visibility that provides value. So you want to think about those articles as providing some kind of value to other people. You want to think about, you know, any other type of visibility that you are trying to get as a way of sharing your gifts or your strengths with other people. When you do that, it really makes a difference as to how people then start to talk about the role that you're playing. Because the other part of getting visibility is then gaining publicity. Publicity is simply other people talking about the brand. So I want to make a distinction between advertising and publicity. Advertising is paid, publicity is unpaid. And that has everything to do with other people understanding what you do, understanding what value you bring to either the organization, an industry, or whatever it is that you are currently working in. So use this example of Dennis Rodman as a way of thinking about your leadership role, how to get visibility, and then that last piece is consistency. Now, let's say that my leadership ability is being organized, and I work in a group of other management consultants. And so we're all fairly good with our ability to work with clients, to identify possible solutions to some of the challenges they're having. But my specialty is I am really organized. And so when someone brings me in on the team, they can expect that I am going to organize this effort in a way that's really clear, that gets the job done in a fairly efficient manner, And the client is always pleased because of the organizational skills that I have. Now, the client meets me for the first time after seeing some of the products, you know, because I'm always going to their office. They decide to come to my office one day, and my office is a complete mess. Really affects the brand. Even though you're delivering, that client is going to still think, wow, how is this possible? And so that's just an example of organization, of being consistent. So you have to be consistent in all aspects of the work that you're presenting to the client, especially if you say that's the leadership role that you're taking. The next area that I want to talk about is the social media. And this is an area that was fairly new to me up until probably last year. I had joined LinkedIn, and this is kind of a way to promote the brand. So once you've, you know, developed the brand strategy, and I'll quickly go through the handouts that I provided for you. But once you've, you know, figured out those three areas, the brand strategy, leadership, visibility, consistency, this is one area to get visibility and to start to promote the brand. So as I mentioned, my first real activity with social media was with LinkedIn. And with LinkedIn, I joined probably about 4 years ago. And I joined because people kept asking me to join. And so that was just sort of my way of, okay, fine, I'll join. And then, you know, maybe people will stop asking me to join. I've joined. So my profile sat pretty dormant for about 3 years. And then I think I started to recognize that people were visiting this profile, and there really wasn't a lot of information there. So how was that really supporting the brand? It's not. So I began to populate my LinkedIn profile. And then I started to recognize that there was really some value in this whole social marketing online activity. And so I started, you know, identifying people that were on LinkedIn and growing my network. And then I think I'd grown the network to about 177 people and had 9 recommendations. And people were finding me from some of my prior jobs and companies. And, you know, this was great. So I decided to purchase a book. And I believe Jason Alba was on the, was part of the series last month, and I had purchased his book about 6 months ago called You're on LinkedIn, Now What? And I would read a chapter and then do what he said to do. And so it started to, I started to gain a better understanding of how to use the tool. There is a portion on the LinkedIn site that's called Groups. And what I did with the groups, I started posting questions to, well, first I joined about 30 groups, and I joined affinity groups, groups that I had a common interest with, groups that would be have interest in the work that I was doing. So as an example, I joined, I think, about 4 or 5 baby boomer groups, and this was after I had written the book, Branding Yourself After Age 50. I also joined some human resource groups, and this was because I was going to speak at the SHRM conference. So I posted questions relative that was relevant to different groups. As an example, with the Branding 50 book, I posted a question asking, can anyone give me some ideas of venues to present workshops or sell books? And I received probably about 30 different responses to this question, great venues. I received an invitation to conduct a radio interview, which I did out of Sacramento, called Living Well Radio. And I also received this invitation from Maisha to present this workshop here on the Georgetown alumni program. So without that social media, without that network, without really focusing on it, I never would have made that connection with Maisha. And so I want to offer that as a really great tool for you to use to start thinking about your current situation. What is it that you're trying to accomplish? You know, are you looking for a job? have you joined some of these networks? Are you maximizing the use of the network? And the other way to brand yourself on some of these networks, and I'll continue to talk about LinkedIn because that's the one I'm most familiar with, is to answer questions that people are posting. You might have a specialty. Look in those areas. Look for the groups of your specialty. Look for the questions that are being posted. And if you can provide some insight for someone else, post answers to those questions. Over time, you begin to develop your brand online, not just as a person with a profile, but an active participant and potentially an expert. So that's, you know, what I wanted to just mention some things about social media. If you have not participated, and I will tell you, a lot of people, when I ask them, well, you know, they'll ask, well, you know, let's keep in touch, you know, let's, you know, stay current, that kind of thing. And I'll ask, well, are you on Facebook? Because it's a great way to stay in touch with people. And they'll look at me like, you know, are you crazy? My kids are on Facebook, is usually the response. So it's not about kids. You know, do yourself a favor, because this media is not going away, and it is a wonderful, wonderful place to network with people that you don't know and to sort of expand their understanding of who you are in the marketplace, but also just to get, you know, engaged with other people doing other things. So the last thing I want to just say before I open up the lines for questions is this is my favorite quote, and this just really summarizes who I've been in the last almost 8 years. Sometimes you just have to take a leap and build your wings on the way down. And so, you know, sometimes we are sort of sitting on that ledge and a little concerned about, you know, what's next and what opportunities are out there or what challenges we might face. But if you decide what it is you want, create that North Star, develop a vision, write it down and make it plain, and then develop your brand strategy around that vision, your leadership capability, what makes you different and special, the visibility, you know, identify a strategy for visibility and consistency, and then just take the leap. The last thing I want to do is to just kind of very quickly go through the packet of information I sent. So on page 2 is a place for you to talk about vision. And to really think about the next 3 years out, what is it that you really want to do? I mean, there's, you know, when people who know me well, after I had completed my master's at Harvard and I told them I was going to become an image consultant, they thought that I drank something, you know, Kool-Aid something at Harvard, and because they always thought I would become a vice president of a corporation. But to just stop midstream and to do something totally different that I had absolutely no background in was a brave, but it was me on the ledge taking a leap, and it was something I absolutely wanted to do and had passion around. And so think about what you want. Really think about this vision statement and create that. Then on page 3, develop your brand leadership. What is it that you want to do? Define your target market first so that you can think about, you know, what do they care about? And then how are you distinguishing yourself in the marketplace? So look at the market, identify the targets, think about what they care about, because remember, marketing a product, even if it is yourself, is always about finding a need and filling it. So how do I fill the need of my target market? And so that's a really, really critical question, because usually what we do, especially at interviews, we'll go to an interview and tell people all about ourselves, the wonderful things that we can do, but we never think about what the target cares about. And so your interview, your marketing strategy should always be based on what the target market needs. The next piece on page 4 is create buzz, and so this is all about thinking about your visibility strategy. And the last part on the bottom of page 4 is consistency. You know, with consistency, you have to look at every aspect of your marketing. You know, if you're going for a job and you're going to an interview, how am I showing up? What am I wearing to the interview? How am I presenting myself? You know, all those kinds of things. If you're in business for yourself, what do my What do my marketing materials look like? Is it consistent with the vision? Is it consistent with the story that I'm telling the marketplace about the services and products that I deliver? On page 5 then becomes just an action plan. So what I want you to do here is at the beginning of each week, identify a goal. And then what did you accomplish in each of these areas? So create, you know, write down the week, identify what you've done to create your leadership strategy or to actually implement the strategy, implement the visibility strategy, and to become more consistent. And I would like to also invite you to a series of Branding Yourself After Age 50 workshops that will be presented on September 15th, 22nd, and 29th. And it will be a little bit more in depth. And also, if you're in the Washington, D.C. area, the 50th Birthday Bash. And you can find out more information about this at branding50.com. So with that, I'd like to turn the program back over to Maisha and answer any questions that have been generated.
Great. Thank you, Marva. That was excellent. And if you haven't received the handout, I just wanted to remind people to check the email account that you use to log in, because that's where we sent the handout to. And additionally, just to kind of piggyback on something Marva shared, was that, you know, Georgetown University has an alumni group on LinkedIn, and I would encourage all of you, when you set your profile up or if you've already had one, to join that group. There are a little over 7,000 alumni in that group, and it's a great group to network alongside other Georgetown grads who are doing various different things, but it's always a great common denominator to start your social networking. If you're a little uncomfortable with it or something you're kind of just now exploring, start there. It's a great place to interact with a lot of other alumni. And to start off with our first question, Marva, the first question asks, I have been approached by several job listing boards that would like to rewrite my resume for a fee, of course. Do you subscribe to this concept?
Actually, I do. Unless you are a professional resume writer, I would suggest having someone write your resume, because a lot of times we think about what we've done and we just, you know, place that information on the paper. But a really good professional resume writer will ask you a lot of questions, and they will develop your resume in a way that you may not have thought about. I mean, they'll pull out your accomplishments. They'll, you know, list it in a way that's easy to read. In addition, the thing that you really need to have nowadays is a resume that has keywords, and that's, I think they call SEO enhanced, so that people can pick it up. If you're placing it on these job boards, they can pick it up based on keywords.
Great, thank you. The next question says, in the nonprofit sector, leaders aren't supposed to be seen as tooting their own horn. One, how can we encourage leaders to be more visible and consistent in developing their own personal brands, not just their nonprofit organizations? And then she has a follow-up question, but is there a correlation between leaders with a strong personal brand and their effectiveness in raising funds and attracting partners or resources to accomplish their mission? So you can, I can repeat any of that.
Okay, you'll need to repeat the second one in just a minute. But for the first one, the question was about people being, you know, seen and not heard. Most people think that there is no personal brand unless you start creating it, but they already have a brand. If they are going about the business of creating a visibility strategy by helping others, especially with whatever that their mission work is in that nonprofit, if they are effective in the work that they're doing, they are creating a personal brand, because people will start to associate that good work with that person. So they, you know, if they don't really want to be, you know, speaking in you know, different areas and that kind of thing, they can still create a brand through good works and just being visible in the communities that they serve. So that's an excellent way for nonprofit people to create the brand, you know, and to distinguish the leader of that organization in the field that they're working. So it doesn't always have to be someone that's speaking, but it could be someone who is visibly working in the communities that they serve. And the second part of that question, if you would repeat it.
Sure. Is there a correlation between leaders with a strong personal brand and their effectiveness in raising funds and attracting partners and resources to accomplish the mission of the organization?
Well, you know, with anything, I think the more visible you are and the more value you're adding to the community you're serving, the more effective you're seen as being. So, you know, I think that the best thing would be to start to look at, you know, what is the fundraising strategy? Where are we trying to attract funds? And then what is our visibility strategy in those areas? And there should be a correlation between the two. So if, you know, if you are not visible in the places that you hope to attract funders, then most likely you're not going to be as effective as you could be. I mean, it could be, you know, visibility strategy could include writing articles around, you know, some issue that's related to that particular industry. It might be, you know, being active in certain organizations in which funders are also active. But there has to be, I think the correlation is more so around value-added services or value-added opportunities. And so you really need to think about, you know, that as the way of getting your name out. You know, what value am I adding to the industry? And that way that attracts funders because they see that their money is going to be spent in a way that's, you know, possibly effective and efficient and has some value-added strategy.
Great, thank you. The next question asks more specifically about what is it about branding from your perspective that is, you know, effective or useful to people over 50? So for boomers, what about what you share today is really most valuable for them?
Well, you know, it all depends on what your interests are. You know, so what is it that you're interested in? What's the North Star? So it always goes back to that. And what's been effective for me in branding myself, and, you know, my business, I started my business at age 42. And in an area where no one knew me. And so it was really important to distinguish myself. And the way I did that was by first joining an association, learning more and more information about the area, volunteering time in a variety of different places that image consultants usually weren't seen. And my first area was with Welfare to Work Women. And so I did a lot of work with underserved communities. And that was how I began to distinguish myself in the field of image consulting. And so that helped to sort of help me to get more visibility. So you really need to think about, you know, what is it that you want to do and what's the area that you want to build your brand in. So branding is important at any age. It doesn't matter if you're 50 or 40 or 20. It's going to help you promote the product. The product is you. And so it's just important to have some strategy and not allow, you know, branding to happen as an accidental situation, but for it to be more intentional.
Great. Do you have a blog where we can ask more questions or discuss the branding concept further?
Okay, so I have a blog. However, we're in the process of updating the blog, and the blog should be back up in probably 2 weeks. But you can always email me at marva@marvagoldsmith.com. And I will, and in fact, I'm going to join the Georgetown group because I didn't realize you had a group. So I'll join the Georgetown group, and so you can also reach me through LinkedIn. But the blog should be back up in about 2 weeks.
Great. As part of brand strategy, do you recommend developing a personal website?
That, you know, I think is a great way to develop an online presence. And, you know, just, you know, again, just depends on what you want to blog about, but or a website. I think it's a great idea. And you just have to decide, you know, what's the message you want to send? What is it that you want people to get about you? Because, you know, more and more online presence is becoming very important for, you know, just people in general. One of the things I'm always talking about, though, is on Facebook sites, you know, because people can post different things on your wall, particularly for younger people, is to make sure that everything that's being posted on your wall is consistent with your vision and what you want people to see or know about you. And in some instances, I have actually had to hide some of my friends because of what they're posting on their walls. And so once you start to develop an online branding strategy, or visibility strategy is really what that is, you really just want to make sure that whatever is being posted is consistent with, you know, your vision for yourself. So the personal website is great because you have complete control of that. But places like, you know, Facebook in particular, and some of the other social media, you want to make sure that whatever is being posted on your wall is what you want people to see or think about you.
Great. Related to that, this question asks, I'm unclear about advantages of Facebook or MySpace for commercial business. What are your thoughts on that?
I don't use Facebook, or especially MySpace. I don't use MySpace at all. My impression of MySpace is that it's more suited for people who are probably in the entertainment industry, because you'll see a lot of singers and different things like that. So I think that that's more suited for that venue. Twitter and Facebook, I think, are more suited towards relationship development. And I have a friend who is, who has in 6 months, she has like 5,000 people following her on Twitter. But what she does, what she tweets about, she provides little tidbits, interesting, videos, information that she finds, different things like that, such that people are just interested in what she's finding. And it's, all on a common theme. So in a commercial aspect, you really want to think about if you are sending out tweets or if you are updating your wall, what are your updates? And a lot of times you'll find that people, you can see the difference between the folks who are just on to, connect with friends, from the past and that kind of thing, and people who are using it more as a commercial vehicle, because the things that they post are different. They'll post things that are informational, that are value-added, some of those kinds of pieces, as opposed to, going down the block for an ice cream or something like that. And I think that that's, where Facebook kind of gets a bad rep. But, again, you want to, just make sure that you are keeping up on what else is being posted on your wall and making sure that your posts are fairly value-added.
Great. Should the brand that one comes up with be an objective or an item on a resume?
I wish the person could say more about that. My guess is what they're, I wouldn't, on a resume, if you're in a creative industry, I think you have more license with, providing things that look like taglines. If you are in a more conservative industry, you probably want to stick with, something that reads like an objective. So it really kind of depends, I think, on the job that you are pursuing as to whether or not, it's a brand statement or, a simple objective.
Great. Do you recommend cold calling or contacting an organization via email to tout your business or services?
No, I don't. And the reason for that is that the number of people who are able to connect with folks on a cold call is usually very, very small, unless they have a niche market. It's just a better use of your resources, especially if it's limited, to, create the relationship, to have some presence. And that's why, some of these things are really important, like the social marketing or the social media, because it does create a consistent, that whole idea of consistency. You can create a consistent relationship with other people who you are connected with by posting the updates or tweeting or answering the questions or those kinds of things. And then, of course, outside of the online media is your common ways of networking with folks in your industry, joining associations, going to the meetings often, taking on a leadership role in those associations. Those are all ways, much better ways, and much more efficient ways to call on, customers. And sometimes it takes a little bit of time, but I think that you'll find it's a better use of your marketing dollar and your resources.
Great. A participant actually shared that a suggestion would be to use your email signature to kind of publicize your brand, either if you have different accounts for your businesses or personal. Or would you offer any other kind of little small things that people can do to publicize their brand?
That, without question, is one of the best ways to not only publicize the brand, but you should have your, just information that you want people to know about you on your signature, but as well your phone number. Because, make it easy for people to contact you. I mean, it's amazing to me when I see business people or professionals that send an email with just their name on the bottom and there's no contact information, especially with, people on Blackberries and they need to, find the person quickly and there's no phone number. So, make sure that you're doing that kind of thing. Always have business cards. Even if you are looking for work, create a business card that has your capabilities on it, that has the information about what makes you different and special. It doesn't have to look gimmicky. It doesn't have to look like a tagline or anything like that, but it should have, a few bullet points as to, what people can expect from you. I also suggest that, there are business cards that look like little small brochures because they are fold-over business cards in which you can get lots more information into it. And so you can almost create a mini brochure for people. That's what I use when I'm speaking. I use a mini brochure because it's fairly expensive to leave a lot of brochures on the table, but it's really inexpensive to provide people with a fold-over business card that has, information about your products and services. So that's also another thing that you might think about is, carrying around that little branded piece of information, whether you're in business, you're looking for work, or whatever, you need to have some kind of business card. The other thing that I found has been kind of interesting, and I think it depends on your industry, but these, what they're calling the online CVs, or online resumes. And if you go to YouTube and just, type in online CV or something of that nature, and you'll see some of these pop up, and they are people who are telling their background. They're very quickly, like in a minute and a half, identifying what makes them different and special. Some of them are well done. Some of them, probably are a brand attraction, but it's an interesting concept. So you might look at some of the more interesting approaches to creating your online brand.
Marva?
Yes.
Sorry.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Are you ready for the next question?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What's the best way to promote your brand if you're very time constrained?
Okay. So, that's a difficult question to answer without having a little more information, but that would depend on the resources that you have available to the resources you have available and what kind of work you're doing. So one of the best ways I've found to promote my business, as an example, is speaking at conferences. Because when I speak at a conference, they are touching and tasting the product. They have a clear understanding of what I deliver. And if they are interested, that's a really, really warm lead. They're going to contact me, and that's how I really launched my business, was by speaking at conferences. So for me, that has been the most effective way to promote my brand. So you can see that that's just an example of someone who has their business And it just depends on, you know, what brand you're trying to promote, what it is about you that you want people to know. So, you know, I hope that, you know, fortunately, I really can't get any more specific than that, but just to offer that example.
Great. And for our last question as we wrap up, can you talk a little bit more about the branding events that you mentioned that are coming up in September? Are they in-person events? Are they online? Or how can people sign up for those?
Well, thank you for the question. You can sign up through branding50.com. And in fact, we just launched the website today, so hopefully it is up. It is 3 one-hour sessions. It's actually going to be I'm using an interactive media such that we will be able to create small communities of people that can talk together. So when we do some of these exercises, you'll actually be able to meet with other people online to discuss, not typing, but actually talking to other people about some of the things that you're doing. So it's 3 sessions. Each will be 1 hour. The birthday bash is going to be in Washington, D.C., and that is going to be a person-to-person. It's going to be a seminar that is from 9 to 3, and the information about that will be placed on the website in October. But you can always call me or email me if you have any questions.
Great. Thank you. I want to thank Marva for her time today and this wonderful presentation on branding yourself. And thank you for participating and joining us today. We had well over 100 people participate in today's presentation, so we're very excited about that. And feel free like I mentioned, join the Georgetown University alumni group, LinkedIn group, on LinkedIn when you join or if you have a profile, check that out. Additionally, feel free to check out our website. If you go to our alumni.georgetown.edu/career-services, and you can check out additional webinars that are coming up, as well as check out archive webinars that we actually have on our website now. So feel free to check back in a couple weeks, and this session will be up as well. Everyone, have a great day, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.